you're listening to this recording, you are ready to read Section 5 of Fahrenheit 451 by Ray Bradbury. I will also be reading the questions that arise in the Actively Learn assignment, so my suggestion is to have the Actively Learn assignment open as well while you are listening to the recording. I will pause and wait for... I'll read the questions, and then you can pause the recording while you answer the questions. Fahrenheit 451. You could feel the war getting ready in the sky that night, the way the clouds moved aside and came back, and the way the stars looked, a million of them swimming between the clouds like the enemy discs, and the feeling that the sky might fall upon the city and turn it to chalk dust, and the moon go up in red fire, and that was how the night felt. Montag walked from the subway with the money in his pocket. He had visited the bank, which was open all night and every night with the robot tellers in attendance. And as he walked, he was listening to the seashell radio in one ear. "We have mobilized a million men. Quick victory is ours if the war comes." Music flooded over the voice quickly, and it was gone. 10 million men mobilized, Faber's voice whispered in his other ear. "But say 1 million. It's happier." "Faber?" "Yes?" "I'm not thinking. I'm just doing like I'm told, like always. You said get the money, and I got it. I didn't really think of it myself. When do I start thinking things out on my own?" "You started already, by saying what you just said. You have to take me on faith." "I took the others on faith." "Yes, and look where we're headed. You have to travel blind for a while. Here's my arm to hold on to." "I don't want to change sides and just be told what to do. There's no reason to change if I do that." "You're wise already." Montag felt his feet moving him on the sidewalk towards his house. "Keep talking. Would you like me to read?" "I'll read so you can remember. I go to bed only 5 hours a night. Nothing to do, so if you like, I'll read you to sleep nights. They say you retain knowledge even when you're sleeping if someone whispers it in your ear." "Yes." "Here." Far away, across town in the night, the faintest whisper of a turned page. The Book of Job. The moon rose in the sky as Montag walked, his lips moving just a trifle. He was eating a light supper at 9 in the evening when the front door cried out in the hall and Mildred ran from the parlor like a native fleeing an eruption of Vesuvius. Mrs. Phelps and Mrs. Bowles came through the front door and vanished into the volcano's mouth with martinis in their hands. Montag stopped eating. They were like a monstrous crystal chandelier tinkling in 1,000 chimes. He saw their Cheshire cat smiles burning through the walls of the house, and now they were screaming at each other over the din. Montag found himself at the parlor door, with his food still in his mouth. "Doesn't everyone look nice?" "Nice. You look fine, Millie." "Fine. Everyone looks swell." "Swell." Montag stood watching them. "Patience," whispered Faber. "I shouldn't be here," whispered Montag, almost to himself. "I should be on my way back to you with the money." "Tomorrow's time enough. Careful." "Isn't this show wonderful?" cried Mildred. "Wonderful." On one wall, a woman smiled and drank orange juice simultaneously. How does she do both at once? Thought Montag insanely. In the other walls, an x-ray of the same woman revealed the contracting journey of the refreshing beverage on its way to her delightful stomach. Abruptly, the room took off on a rocket flight into the clouds. It plunged into a lime-green sea where blue fish ate red and yellow fish. A minute later, three white cartoon clowns chopped off each other's limbs to the accompaniment of immense incoming tides of laughter. 2 minutes more and the room whipped out of town to the jets cars wildly circling an arena, bashing and backing up and bashing each other again. Montag saw a number of bodies fly in the air. Question 45. The paragraph above describes the images on the parlor walls. Based on the images, what values and ideas does this society value? Choose the best answer. Violence and competition, good hygiene and healthy living, or learning and growing? Please pause the recording if you need more time to answer the question. Millie, did you see that? I saw it. I saw it. Montag reached inside the parlor wall and pulled the main switch. The images drained away as if water had been let out from a gigantic crystal bowl of hysterical fish. Three women turned slowly and looked with unconcealed irritation and then dislike at Montag. When do you suppose the war will start? He said. I notice your husbands aren't here tonight. Oh, they come and go, said Mrs. Phelps. In and out again, Finnegan. The army called Pete yesterday. He'll be back next week. The army said so. Quick war. 48 hours, they said, and everyone home. That's what the army said. Quick war. Pete was called yesterday, and they said he'd be back. Back next week. Quick, three women fidgeted and looked nervously at the empty mud-colored walls. I'm not worried, said Mrs. Phelps. I'll let Pete do all the worrying, she giggled. I'll let old Pete do all the worrying. Not me, I'm not worried. Yes, said Millie, let old Pete do the worrying. It's always someone else's husband who dies, they say. I've heard that too. I've never known any dead men killed in a war. Killed jumping off buildings, yes, like Gloria's husband last week. But from wars? No. Not from wars, said Mrs. Phelps. Anyway, Pete and I always said, no tears, nothing like that. It's our third marriage each, and we're independent. Be independent, we always said. He said, if I get killed off, you just go right ahead and don't cry, but get married again and don't think of me. That reminds me, said Mildred, did you see the Clara Dove 5-minute romance last night in your wall? Well, it was the one about this woman who... Montag said nothing, but stood looking at the woman's faces as he had once looked at the faces of saints in a strange church he had entered when he was a child. The faces of those enameled creatures meant nothing to him, though he talked to them and stood in that church for a long time, trying to be of that religion, trying to know what that religion was, trying to get enough of the raw incense and special dust of the place into his lungs, and thus into his blood, to feel touched and concerned by the meaning of the colorful men and women with the porcelain eyes and the blood-ruby lips. But there was nothing, nothing. It was a stroll through another store, and his currency strange and unusable there, and his passion cold, even when he touched the wood and plaster and clay. So it was now, in his own parlor, with these women twisting in their chairs under his gaze, lighting cigarettes, blowing smoke, touching their sun-fired hair and examining their blazing fingernails as if they had caught fire from his look. Their faces grew haunted with silence. They leaned forward at the sound of Montag swallowing his last final bite of food. They listened to the feverish breathing. The three empty walls of the room were like the pale brows of sleeping giants now, empty of dreams. Montag felt that if you touched these three staring brows, you would feel a fine salt sweat on your fingertips. The perspiration gathered with the silence and the sub-audible trembling around and about and in the women who were burning with tension. Any moment they might hiss a long sputtering hiss and explode. Montag moved his lips. Let's talk. The women jerked and stared. How are your children, Mrs. Phelps? He asked. You know, I haven't any. No one in his right mind, the good Lord knows, would have children, said Mrs. Phelps, not quite sure why she was angry with this man. I wouldn't say that, said Mrs. Bowles. I've had 2 children by cesarean section. No use going through all the agony for a baby. The world must reproduce, you know. The race must go on. Besides, they sometimes just look at you like... Besides, they sometimes look just like you, and that's nice. 2 cesareans tamed the trick. Yes, sir. Oh, my doctor said, cesareans aren't necessary. You've got the hips for it. Everything's normal. But I insisted. Cesareans are not. Children are ruinous. You're out of your mind, said Mrs. Phelps. I plunk the children in school 9 days out of 10. I put up with them when they come home 3 days a month. It's not that bad. It's not bad at all. You leave them in the parlor and turn the switch. It's like washing clothes. Stuff laundry in and slam the lid. Mrs. Bowles tittered. They'd just as soon kick me as kiss me. Thank God I can kick back. The women showed their tongues, laughing. Mildred sat at a moment and then, seeing that Montag was still in the door, clapped her hands. Let's talk politics, to please Guy. Sounds fine, said Mrs. Bowles. I voted last election, same as everyone, and I laid it on the line for President Noble. I think he's one of the nicest-looking men who ever became president. Oh, but the man they ran against him, he wasn't much, was he? Kind of small and homely, and he didn't shave too close or comb his hair very well? What possessed the outs to run him? You just don't go running a little short man like that against a tall man. Besides, he mumbled. Half the time I couldn't hear a word he said, and the words I did hear I didn't understand. Fat, too, and didn't dress to hide it. No wonder the landslide was for Winston Noble. Even their names helped. Compare Winston Noble to Hubert Hogue for 10 seconds, and you can almost figure the results. Damn it, cried Montag. What do you know about Hogue and Noble? Why, they were right in the parlor wall not 6 months ago. One was always picking his nose. It drove me wild. Well, Mr. Montag, said Mrs. Phelps, do you want us to vote for a man like that? Mildred beamed. You just want to run away from the door, Guy. Don't make us nervous. But Montag was gone and back in a moment with a book in his hand. Guy! Damn it all, damn it all, damn it! What have there, isn't that a book? I thought that all the special training these days was done by film. Mrs. Phelps blinked. You reading up on fireman theory? Theory? Hell, said Montag. It's poetry. Montag, a whisper. Leave me alone. Montag felt himself turning in a great circling roar and buzz and hum. Montag, hold on. Don't. Did you hear them? Did you hear these monsters talking about monsters? Oh, God, the way they jabber about people and their own children and themselves, and the way they talk about their husbands and the way they talk about war. Damn it! I'll stand here and I can't believe it. I didn't say a single word about any war, I'll have you know, said Mrs. Phelps. As for poetry, I hate it, said Mrs. Bowles. Have you ever read any? Montag, Faber's voice scraped away at him. You'll ruin everything. Shut up, you fool. All three women were on their feet. Sit down. They sat. I'm going home, quavered Mrs. Bowles. Montag, please, in the name of God, what are you up to? Pleaded Faber. Why don't you just read us one of these poems from your little book, Mrs. Phelps noted, nodded. I think that he's very interesting. That's not right, wailed Mrs. Bowles. We can't do that. Well, look at Mr. Montag. He wants to. I know he does. And if we listen nice, Mr. Montag will be happy, and then maybe we can go on and do something else. She glanced nervously at the long emptiness of the walls enclosing them. Montag, go through with this and I'll cut off. I'll leave, the beetle jabbed his ear. What good is this? What'll you prove? Scare hell out of him, that's what. Scare the living daylights out. Mildred looked at the empty chair. Now, Guy, just who are you talking to? A silver needle pierced his brain. Montag, listen. Only one way out. Play it as a joke. Cover up. Pretend you aren't mad at all. Then walk to your wall incinerator and throw the book in. Mildred had already anticipated this in a quavery voice. Ladies, once a year, every fireman's allowed to bring one book home from the old days to show his family how silly it all was, how nervous that sort of thing can make you, how crazy. Guy's surprise tonight is to read you one sample to show how mixed up things were, so none of us will ever have to bother our little old heads about that junk again. Isn't that right, darling? He crushed the book in his fist. Say yes. His mouth moved like Faber's. Yes. Mildred snatched the book with a laugh. Here, read this one. No, I take it back. Here's that really funny one you read out loud today. Ladies, you won't understand a word. It goes umpty-tumpty-ump. Go ahead, Guy. That page, dear. He looked at the open page. A fly stirred its wings softly in his ear. Read. What's the title, dear? Dover Beach. His mouth was numb. Now read in a nice, clear voice and go slow. The room was blazing hot. He was all fire. He was all coldness. They sat in the middle of an empty desert with three chairs and him standing, swaying, and him waiting for Mrs. Phelps to stop straightening her dress hem and Mrs. Bowles to take her fingers away from her hair. Then he began to read in a low, stumbling voice that grew firmer as he progressed from line to line, and his voice went out across the desert into the whiteness and around the three sitting women there in the great, hot emptiness. The sea of faith was once too all that full, and round earth's shore lay like the folds of a bright girdle furled. But now I only hear its melancholy, long, withdrawing roar, retreating to the breath of the night wind down the vast edges, drear and naked shingles of the world. The chairs creaked under the three women. Montag finished it out. Ah, love, let us be true to one another. For the world which seems to lie before us like a land of dreams, so various, so beautiful, so new, hath really neither joy, nor love, nor light, nor certitude, nor peace, nor help for pain, and we are here as on a darkling plain, swept with confused alarms of struggling and flight, where ignorant armies clash by night. Mrs. Phelps is crying. The others in the middle of the desert watched her crying grow very loud as her face squeezed itself out of shape. They sat, not touching her, bewildered by her display. She sobbed uncontrollably. Montag himself was stunned and shaken. Question 46. Mrs. Phelps begins to cry while listening to Montag read Dover Beach. Why do you think she cries? Support your answer with at least one piece of evidence from the story. Should pause the recording to answer the question and then unpause the recording after you finish the question. Said Mildred. You're all right, Clara. Now, Clara, snap out of it. Clara, what's wrong? I, sobbed Mrs. Phelps. I don't know, don't know. I just don't know. Oh. Mrs. Bowles stood up and glared at Montag. You see, I knew it. That's what I wanted to prove. I knew it would happen. I've always said poetry and tears, poetry and suicide and crying and awful feelings, poetry and sickness, all that mush. Now I've had it proved to me. You're nasty, Mr. Montag. You're nasty. Faber said, now? Montag felt himself turn and walk to the wall slot and drop the book in through the brass notch to the waiting flames. Silly words, silly words, silly, awful, hurting words, said Mrs. Bowles. Why do you people want to hurt people? Not enough to hurt in the world, you've got to tease people with stuff like that? Clara, now Clara, begged Mildred, pulling her arm. Come on, let's be cheery. You turn the family on now. Go ahead, let's laugh and be happy. Now stop crying, we'll have a party. No, said Mrs. Bowles, I'm trotting right home, right straight home. You want to visit my house and family well and good, but I won't come in this fireman's crazy house again in my lifetime. Go home. Montag fixed his eyes upon her quietly. Go home and think of your first husband divorced, and your second husband killed in a jet, and your third husband blowing his brains out. Go home and think of a dozen abortions you've had. Go home and think of that and your damn cesarean sections too, and your children who hate your guts. Go home and think about it all. Think how it all happened. And what did you ever do to stop it? Go home, go home, he yelled, before I knock you down and kick you out of the door. Door slammed and the house was empty. Montag stood alone in the winter weather, with the parlor walls the color of dirty snow. In the bathroom, water ran. He heard Mildred shake the sleeping tablets into her hand. Fool, Montag, fool, fool. Oh, God, you silly fool. Shut up! He pulled the green bullet from his ear and jammed it into his pocket. Question 47. Montag had succeeded in making all the ladies upset, but was that what he wanted? What do you think Montag hoped to accomplish by reading the poetry? Use details from the story to support your answer. Please pause the recording if you need more time to answer the question. It sizzled faintly. Fool. Fool. He searched the house and found the books where Mildred had stacked them behind the refrigerator. Some were missing, and he knew that she had started on her own slow process of dispersing the dynamite in her house, stick by stick. But he was not angry now, only exhausted and bewildered with himself. He carried the books into the backyard and hid them in the bushes near the alley fence. For tonight only, he thought, in case she decides to do any more burning. He went back through the house. Mildred? He called at the door of the darkened bedroom. There was no sound. Outside, crossing the lawn on his way to work, he tried not to see how completely dark and deserted Clarice McClellan's house was. On the way downtown, he was so completely alone with his terrible error that he felt the necessity for the strange warmness and goodness to come from a familiar and gentle voice speaking in the night. Already in a few short hours, it seemed that he had known Faber a lifetime. Now he knew that he was two people, that he was above all Montag, who knew nothing, who did not even know himself a fool, but only suspected it. And he knew that he was also the old man who talked to him and talked to him and talked to him as the train was sucked from one end of the night city to the other on one long sickening gasp of motion. In the days to follow and in the nights where there was no moon and in the nights where there was a very bright moon shining on the earth, the old man would go on with his talking and this talking, drop by drop, stone by stone, flake by flake. His mind would well over at last, and he would not be Montag anymore. This old man told him, assured him, promised him. He would be Montag plus Faber, fire plus water. And then one day, after everything had mixed and simmered and worked away in silence, there would be neither fire nor water, but wine. Out of two separate and opposite things, a third. And one day he would look back upon the fool and know the fool. Even now he could start to feel the long journey, the leave-taking, the going away from the self he had been. It was good listening to the beetle hum, the sleeping mosquito buzz, and the delicate filigree murmur of the old man's voice at the first scolding him and then consoling him in the late hour of the night as he emerged from the steamy subway toward the firehouse world. Pity, Montag, pity. Don't haggle and nag them. You were so recently one of them yourself. They are so confident that they will run on forever, but they won't run on. They don't know that this is all one huge big blazing meteor that makes a pretty fire in the sky, but that someday it'll have to hit. They see only the blaze, the pretty fire, as you saw it. Montag, old men who stay at home afraid, tending to their peanut brittle bones, have no right to criticize. Yet you almost killed things at the start. Watch it. I'm with you, remember that. I understand how it happened. I must admit that your blind raging invigorated me. God, how young I felt. But now, I want you to feel old. I want a little of my cowardice to be distilled in you tonight. The next few hours, when you see Captain Beatty, tiptoe around him. Let me hear him for you. Let me feel the situation out. Survival is our ticket. Forget the poor, silly women. I made them unhappier than they have been in years, I think, said Montag. It shocked me to see Mrs. Phelps cry. Maybe they're right. Maybe it's best not to face things, to run, have fun. I don't know. I feel guilty. No, you mustn't. If there were no war, if there was peace in the world, I'd say fine, have fun. But Montag, you mustn't go back to being just a fireman. All isn't well with the world. Montag perspired. Montag, you listening? My feet, said Montag, I can't move them. I feel so damn silly. My feet won't move. Listen, easy now, said the old man gently. I know. You're afraid of making mistakes. Don't be. Mistakes can be profited by. Man, when I was young, I shoved my ignorance in people's faces. They beat me with sticks. By the time I was 40, my blunt instrument had been honed to a fine cutting point for me. If you hide your ignorance, no one will hit you and you'll never learn. Now, pick up your feet into the firehouse with you. We're twins. We're not alone anymore. We're not separated out in different parlors with no contact between. If you need help when Beatty pries at you, I'll be sitting right here in the eardrum making notes. Montag felt his right foot, then his left foot move. Old man, he said, stay with me. The mechanical hound was gone. Its kennel was empty, and the firehouse stood all about in plaster silence, and the orange salamander slept with its kerosene in its belly, and the fire throwers crossed upon its flanks. And Montag came in through the silence and touched the brass pole and slid up in the dark air, looking back at the deserted kennel, his heart beating, pausing, beating. Faber was a gray moth asleep in his ear for the moment. But he stood near the drop hole waiting, but with his back turned as if he were not waiting. Well, he said to the men playing cards, here comes a very strange beast, which in all tongues is called a fool. He put his hand to one side, palm up for a gift. Montag put the book in it. Without even glancing at the title, Beatty tossed the book into the trash basket and lit a cigarette. Who are a little wise the best fools be? Welcome back, Montag. I hope you'll be staying with us now that your fever is done and your sickness is over. Sit in for a hand of poker. They sat and the cards were dealt. In Beatty's sight, Montag felt the guilt of his hands. His fingers were like ferrets that had done some evil and now never rested, always stirred and picked and hid in pockets, moving from under Beatty's alcohol-flamed stare. If Beatty so much as breathed on them, Montag felt that his hands might wither, turn over on their sides, and never be shook to life again. They would be buried the rest of his life in his coat sleeves, forgotten. For these were the hands that had acted on their own, no part of him. Here was where the conscience first manifested itself to snatch books, dart off with Job and Ruth and Willie Shakespeare, and now in the firehouse, these hands seemed gloved with blood. Twice in half an hour, Montag had to rise from the game and go to the latrine to wash his hands. When he came back, he hid his hands under the table. Beatty laughed. Let's have your hands in sight, Montag. Not that we don't trust you, understand, but they all laughed. Well, said Beatty, the crisis is past and all is well. The sheep return to the fold. We're all sheep who have strayed at times. Truth is truth to the end of my reckoning, we've cried. They are never alone that are accompanied with noble thoughts. We've shouted to ourselves, sweet food of sweetly uttered knowledge, Sir Philip Sidney said. But on the other hand, words are like leaves, and where they most abound, much fruit of sense beneath is rarely found. Alexander Pope, what do you think of that? I don't know. Careful, whispered Montag, living in another world far away. Or this, a little learning is a dangerous thing. Drink deep or taste not the Pyrian spring. There, shallow draughts intoxicate the brain, and drinking largely sobers us again. Pope, same essay. Where does that put you? Montag bit his lip. I'll tell you, said Beatty, smiling at his cards, that made for a little while a drunkard. That made you for a little while a drunkard. Read a few lines and off you go over the cliff. Bang, you're ready to blow. blow up the world, chop off heads, knock down women and children, destroy authority. I know, I've been through it all. I'm all right, said Montag nervously. Stop blushing. I'm not needling, really, I'm not. Do you know I had a dream an hour ago? I lay down for a cat nap, and in this dream, you and I, Montag, got into a furious debate on books. You towered with rage, yelled quotes at me. I calmly parried every thrust. Power, I said, and you, quoting Dr. Johnson, said, knowledge is more than equivalent to force. And I said, well, Dr. Johnson also said, dear boy, that he is no wise man that will quit a certainty for an uncertainty. Stick with Fireman Montag. All else is dreary chaos. Don't listen, whispered Faber. He's trying to confuse. He's slippery. Watch out. Beatty chuckled. And you said, quoting, truth will come to light. Murder will not be hid long. And I cried in good humor, oh God, he speaks only of his horse. And the devil can cite scripture for his purpose. And you yell, this age thinks better of a gilded fool than of a threadbare saint in wisdom school. And I whisper gently, the dignity of truth is lost with much protesting. And you screamed, carcasses bleed in the sight of the murderer. And I said, patting your hand, what, do I give you trench mouth? And you shrieked, knowledge is power. And a dwarf on a giant's shoulder of the furthest of the two. And I summed my side up with a rare serenity and the folly of mistaking a metaphor for a proof, a torrent of verbiage for a spring of capital truths, and oneself as an oracle is inborn in us, Mr. Valerie once said. Montag's head whirled sickeningly. He felt beaten unmercifully on brow, eyes, nose, lips, chin, and shoulders, on upflailing arms. He wanted to yell, no, shut up, you're confusing things, stop it. Beatty's graceful fingers thrust out to seize his wrist. God, what a pulse. I've got you going, have I, Montag? Jesus, God, your pulse sounds like the day after the war. Everything but sirens and bells. Shall I talk some more? I like your look of panic. Swahili, Indian, English lit, I speak them all. A kind of excellent dumb discourse, Willie. Montag, hold on. The moth brushed Montag's ear. He's muddying the waters. Oh, you were scared silly, said Beatty, for I was doing a terrible thing in using the very books you clung to rebut you on every hand, on every point. What traitors' books can be? You think they're backing you up, and they turn on you. Others can use them too, and there you are, lost in the middle of the moor, in a great welter of nouns and verbs and adjectives. And at the very end of my dream, along I came with a salamander and said, going my way? And you got in, and we drove back to the firehouse in beatific silence, all dwindled away to peace. Question 48. Why does Beatty share his dream with Montag? What is his goal? A. Beatty wants Montag to think the books are unreliable. B. Beatty is trying to show off for Montag. C. Montag didn't know Beatty read books, and this was Beatty's way of letting Montag know. Or D. Beatty has never had a dream before. Pause the recording if you need more time to answer this question. Beatty let Montag's wrist go, let the hand slump limply on the table. All's well that is well in the end. Silence. Montag sat like a carved white stone. The echo of the final hammer on his skull died slowly away in the black cavern where Faber waited for the echoes to subside. And then, when the startled dust had settled down around Montag's mind, Faber began softly. All right, he's had his say. You must take it in. I'll say my say, too, in the next few hours, and you'll take it in, and you'll try to judge them and make your decision as to which way to jump or fall. But I want it to be your decision, not mine and not the captain's. But remember that captain belongs to the most dangerous enemy of truth and freedom, the solid, unmoving cattle of the majority. Oh, God, the terrible tyranny of the majority. We all have our harps to play. It's up to you now to know which ear you'll listen. Montag opened his mouth to answer Faber and was saved this error in the presence of others when the station bell rang. The alarm voice in the ceiling chanted. There was a tacking, tacking sound as the alarm report telephone typed out the address across the room. Captain Beatty, his poker cards in one pink hand, walked with exaggerated slowness to the phone and ripped out the address when the report was finished. He glanced perfunctorily at it and shoved it in his pocket. He came back and sat down. The others looked at him. It can wait exactly 40 seconds while I take all the money away from you, said Beatty happily. Montag put his cards down. Tired, Montag? Going out of this game? Yes. Hold on. Well, come to think of it, we can finish this hand later. Just leave your cards face down and hustle the equipment. On the double now. And Beatty rose up again. Montag, you don't look well. I'd hate to think you were coming down with another fever. I'll be all right. You'll be fine. This is a special case. Come on, jump for it. They leaped into the air and clutched the brass pole as if it were the last vantage point above a tidal wave passing below. And then the brass pole, to their dismay, slid them down into darkness, into the blast and the cough and the suction of the gaseous dragon, roaring to life. Hey! They rounded a corner in thunder and siren, with concussion of tires, with scream of rubber, with a shift of kerosene bulk in the glittery brass tank, like the food in the stomach of a giant, with Montag's fingers jolting off the silver rail, swinging into cold space with the wind tearing his hair back from his head, with the wind whistling in his teeth, and with all the wild thinking of the women, the chaff women in their parlor tonight, with the kernels blown out from under them by a neon wind, and his silly damned reading of a book to them. How like trying to put out fires with water pistols, how senseless and insane. One rage turned in for another, one anger displacing another. When would he stop being entirely mad and be quiet, be very quiet indeed? Here we go! Montag looked up. Beatty never drove, but he was driving tonight, slamming the salamander around corners, leaning forward high on the driver's throne, his massive black slicker flapping out behind so that he seemed like a great black bat flying above the engine, over the brass numbers, taking the full wind. Here we go to keep the world happy, Montag. Beatty's pink, phosphorescent cheeks glimmered in the high darkness, and he was smiling furiously. Here we are. The salamander boomed to a halt, throwing men off in slips and clumsy hops. Montag stood, fixing his raw eyes to the cold, bright rail under his clenched fingers. I can't do it, he thought. How can I go at this new assignment? How can I go on burning things? I can't go in this place. Beatty, smelling of the wind through which he had rushed, was at Montag's elbow. All right, Montag? The men ran like cripples in their clumsy boots as quietly as spiders. At last, Montag raised his eyes and turned. Beatty was watching his face. Something the matter, Montag? Why, said Montag slowly, we've stopped in front of my house. Question 49. This is a poll question. Someone called in an alarm on Montag. Who do you think did it? Mildred, one of Mildred's friends, Beatty, or Faber? This is the end of